Going to turn to Psalm 53, verses 1 through 3. Psalm 53, 1 through 3. Mankind's predicament. You know, Psalm 53 is almost a repeat of Psalm 14. Psalm 53 and Psalm 14 are basically the same. What is a predicament? It's an unpleasant situation that is difficult to get out of. Ever been in that? If you're engaged to get married but suddenly fall in love with someone else, you've gotten yourself into quite a predicament, right? We saw that on a TV show the other day. If you are, you owe the IRS $10,000, you're in a predicament, right? If you owe the IRS $1, you're not in too bad a predicament. But there are predicaments. Mankind is in a predicament. The thing that we need to understand is most people don't understand the predicament they're in. Some people can just ignore trouble and owing people and debt. You know, they can just go right on like nothing's wrong. And some people can be on the run from the law and for years and never and live normal lives, live two lives. The problem is they don't understand the seriousness, the trouble that they're in. People can have serious health issues and don't even realize it, or they may realize it and ignore it. Mankind's in a predicament because the Lord is getting ready to return and get His church, and people don't even know the predicament they're in. It's like heading down a road where the bridge is out. You're speeding full speed ahead, 75 miles an hour, and the bridge is out a mile down the road. They're just going right on. They don't realize the danger that's ahead. They think if they ignore it, it's going to go away. Have you ever ignored a problem and it went away? Doesn't happen, does it? I pray the Lord will help us to fully understand the seriousness of the hour and the shortness of time and the predicament that people are in. People are in a situation they cannot get out of themselves. They are facing judgment from God. There's no hope of getting out of it. To ignore the Word of God, to ignore the Lord Jesus Christ, is to your peril. Great sermon preached by R.G. Lee, the longtime pastor at Bellevue Baptist Church in Memphis. Famous sermon, Payday Someday. Look it up sometime. You can still hear him preach it on recording. Payday Someday. It's a terrifying passage about people slipping into hell and sliding into hell, unprepared, not getting ready. There's no hope, no way out. Psalm 53:1, the fool that said in his heart, there is no God. There is no God. Some people are just fools and ignore the predicament. Corrupt are they and have done abominable iniquity. There is none that doeth good. Fools say to themselves, empty-headed. That's what the word fool means, empty-headed. No brain. We were talking about, Kelly said we use 10% of our brains this morning in Sunday school. Some less. Nobody anymore. Most of us less, right? Empty-headed person says there's no God. You know what this word, this phrase really means is no God of Israel or no God of creation for me. As far as I'm concerned, I'm living like there is no God. There may be one. There probably is one, they're saying. But I'm going to live like there is no God. That is a fool, right? I'm going to live like there is no moral accountability. I'm going to do anything I want, live anything, any way I want. In the Bible, the term fool does not mean mental incompetence, but moral and spiritual insensitivity. Totally ignorant of God, the Word of God, and all of the Gospel. Moral and spiritual insensitivity. You ever known anybody that just doesn't care about God, doesn't care about where he's going to spend eternity. He doesn't even think about it. Doesn't live like he thinks about it. The fool is one who ignores God, empty-headed. A fool is a person who acts unwisely or imprudently, according to the dictionary. A fool is a person who acts unwisely or imprudently. A silly person. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Romans 1:22. This describes our world today. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Empty-headed. No knowledge. Psalm 53:1 says, corrupt are they. They are all corrupt that show ignorance, a contempt for the Word of God. Having a showing, a willingness to act dishonestly in return for money or personal gain. They would rather have personal happiness and personal gain and wealth and money and fame than God. Does that describe a place out west? And most of the world? Did that describe Hollywood, TV, and all that stuff? All they're out for is personal gain and money and happiness. They believe happiness equals stuff, money and things. Genesis 6:12, and God looked upon the earth. God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. It was corrupt. All flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth, God said in Genesis 6:12. All flesh. Psalm 53:1 says, and they've all done abominable iniquity. Have all done abominable iniquity. They have done terrible, detestable things before God. They are corrupt and evil. They have committed repulsive injustice. Moral revulsion. Loathsome, detestable, hateful, odious, obnoxious, despicable, contemptible, damnable, cursed, and accursed. That's what abominable means. I wouldn't want to be facing God having been committed an abomination, would you? God has contempt towards you. Oh my, we don't think about that. We think God loves everybody. He does. He's not willing that any should perish. But there is a just God and a holy God and a righteous God. And he has contempt for sin. And you're going to face God with sin in your life without your sins covered. Titus 1:16, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient, and do every good work reprobate. Reprobate. That word turns up in Romans to describe people today. Psalm 53 says, verse 1, there is none that doeth good. None. Zero. That means absolutely nobody. There's no human that does good. We're all sinners. There is no one who seeks after God. None do good or have the capability to do good. No one has the ability on their own to earn their salvation or any favor with God. You cannot earn favor with God by doing good works. You can only earn favor with God by being perfect, holy, and righteous. There's only one who earned God's favor, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
People are in a predicament because they don't realize, but a lot of them do realize, they're sinners and on their way to hell, but they just don't care. They don't want to surrender to God. They don't want to surrender their lives to the Lord. They're afraid they have to give up something. They're afraid they're going to have to change. And they are. They have to repent and totally change and become new creatures. You have to be a new person. God doesn't repair your heart. He gives you a new heart. Who would want an old heart that's repaired? If I had heart trouble, I wouldn't want an old repaired heart. I'd want a new heart if I had a choice, right? Give me a new heart. That's what God does. And he gets us out of this predicament. Men are in a predicament. Mankind is in a predicament. They're sliding, descending to hell. And just laugh about it. People laugh it up and party it up. And proclaim how good they are on television. How righteous we are that we allow women to abort, have choice and abort their babies. Oprah Winfrey, I read in a thing yesterday, said, it wasn't Oprah Winfrey, it was an actress. She said she aborted her baby so she could save the world, help save the world. So she would have time to help save the world. Rose McGowan, that was her name. I aborted my baby so I would have time to save the world. Isn't that righteous? See, they make it like it's a woman's choice, and it's righteous. It's good. But the Bible quickly puts that to rest. The Bible quickly puts the fact that man thinks he's worth it to God, that man can be proud before God, with this very passage when God says, the fool has said in his heart, there's no God. There is none that doeth good. None. Some are fools. Secondly, some lack understanding. Psalm 53:2. God looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there were any that did understand, that did seek God. God looked down from heaven upon the children of men. God looks down from heaven at people. God observed. God looks down from heaven upon the children of men. Only this verse in Psalm 14 mentions God looking down from heaven. Revelation 2:23, I am He which searcheth the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. Genesis 11:5, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. God observes what's going on in this world. Nothing is getting by. Nobody's getting by with anything. We cry out, God, did you know what's going on here? Lord, remember us. He watches us. He watches the evil and the good. There's none good but one. That's God. But in our righteousness that's given to us by Christ, God is watching us. We've heard Christ's goodness put upon us. Psalm 53:2 says, to see if there were any that did understand. To see if anyone who was wise, to see if there's anyone who understands the predicament that they're in. The people understand the predicament. Only by the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit convicts us, do we understand. That's what the Holy Spirit convicts us about, is our sin and our predicament. Psalm 119:73, Thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding. This is what we should pray for people. Lord, help people to understand that they're in a predicament, that they're lost before God, that they're a sinner in need of a Savior. Help people to understand that they're sinners. That's the first thing we have to understand, is that we have sinned against God in order to be saved, right? Nobody comes forward or trusts Christ and says, Lord, aren't you glad you got me? I'm one of the best. No, the Holy Spirit humbles us, convicts us. We talk about convict people. Lord, convict people of their sin. I was convicted of my sin. You were convicted of your sin. We see a holy God and we realize we're in trouble. The Holy Spirit helps us to see God is holy, we're not. So we'll trust in Christ and be made holy. Psalm 53:2, to see if there were any that did understand, that did seek God. Will God find any who worship Him? Not naturally. Who naturally seeks after God? Who requires Him? Who longs for Him as essential to life? None without Christ, without the Holy Spirit. Here's the answer, Jeremiah 29:13. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. You have to have a heart after God. A heart that wants to find God. I'm stepping on a step. Here. See, I wasn't seeking for that pen, but it found me. See, that's what God does. We don't seek for Him, but He finds us and gives us a heart after Him. The Holy Spirit causes us to seek after God, to want to find the Lord Jesus Christ. People just don't understand that they're separated from God. They don't understand that our life comes from God. They don't understand that they're sinners before a holy God. That's what it means to see if they did understand. They don't understand. You know, I'll never understand the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, the Holy Spirit. I understand enough of it, though. I'll never understand all the mysteries of God, but I understand enough to know that Jesus Christ is the answer. God lets us know enough. We can never understand all the Word of God. It's so marvelous and wonderful. But we can understand enough. God lets us understand enough. But people don't even inquire of the Word of God. They think it's an old-fashioned, outdated book. Let me tell you, the Bible is as recent as this morning's headlines. That's how up-to-date it is. The Bible is not. We don't have to be ashamed. Well, I believe the Bible. Sorry. You know, we don't have to hide our face in shame. We can proudly say, I believe the Word of God.
Amen.
Because it is the Word of God, proven by prophecy that has come to pass. Proven by a Savior who gave us peace. You know, when you trust Christ as your Savior, you have peace that surpasses all understanding. You have joy. You have one man came to accept Christ, and he came to a Billy Graham revival, a crusade, with a beer in his hand, hiding in his pocket, in his coat, and he said, "I'm going to drink this beer throughout the whole service." And he would drink that beer, and he had another one. "I'm going to drink another one." By the time the message was over and the invitation came, he had dropped the beer and went forward to trust in Christ because his heart was changed. He thought he could just, whatever, I can just sit here and I'm going to be whatever I want to be. And I'm going to show God. Well, he said God showed him through the preaching of the Word of God. When it got into his heart, he dropped that beer. He said, "I'd never drop a beer half drunk. I just dropped it and went to receive." Didn't know what happened to me. He said he arrived up front and said, "What happened? I want to be saved. I don't know why. I want Jesus." Because the Bible was preached. The Word of God was preached. He understood he was in a predicament. He looked at his beer and said, "Beer or Christ?" He just dropped the beer. Some are fools. Some lack understanding. I don't know why people think that they've got it all figured out. I was at the funeral home with Ellen's wake, and one of those guys reminded me what I used to say about a toaster. Fred Mills, his dad passed away. And he reminded me of my little story all the time. People think they've figured out God but can't put together a toaster. You know, one of the most simple things. I can't put together a toaster, but it's pretty simple, I'd say. But I've figured out God doesn't exist. I understand everything. Well, buddy, my toaster's torn up. Well, I can't fix that. Well, buddy, I don't trust your... If you can't fix a toaster, I doubt very seriously you've figured out God. And you can prove to me, can you prove to me God doesn't exist? I sure can. Well, my toaster's tore up. I don't know nothing about toasters. Well, I ain't trusting you about God. Yeah, we trust Hollywood people. What have I told you? Who make a living lying. They pretend. And they tell us, they're going to tell us and preach to us. The Oscars the other night, they preached to us. I spit that far past that table that time. That has to be a record. I'm glad nobody was sitting there. Hollywood thinks, to preach to us.
It makes me want to spit there.
Yeah. To preach to us how to live and the righteousness. There are cesspools of iniquity and sin, and they dare preach to us. You better not have watched the Oscars. Who did? Don't raise your hand. Let me tell you what Mamaw and Papaw did. They put them in the dark. When I was there, Jack, turn off that TV. I was their remote. I was my dad's remote. Put them in the dark. We need to put some of these TV shows and these, I don't go to movies anymore. Nothing worth watching. Unless there's a superhero or a horse in it, I won't watch it.
There you go.
I mean, that's pretty much. And lastly, we are all filthy. Psalm 53:3, every one of them has gone back, every one, they are altogether become filthy. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Boy, they emphasize this, the author of Psalms, about man being no good, right? That's the exact opposite. You're going to hurt little Tommy if you tell him he's a sinner, if you let him fail, if you keep a score. I read a great article about a guy who said, we're raising mamby-pamby, wimpy people who's afraid to lose. We can't tell them you lost the game. You're still a winner with me. I put a big L on their head. You're a loser. You lost. Let's give them all a trophy for participation. Does God give us all a participation trophy? Yeah, you were. I created you. I made you. Let's all go to heaven. Hey, there's requirements. We're sinners. We didn't make the grade. We need to be saved. Hey, we expect children to excel in everything and dumb it down so they can. Instead of having, you know, we all can't be NBA players, so find something else to do to be successful at. Be a woodworker. Be a ditch digger, but be the best you can. We want to make kids successful in everything, so we make it easy for all of them. You know, we're allowing women to get in the Navy SEALs and the Range Army Rangers. And they had to, there's a test for women and a test for men. Well, the men complained, said that's not fair. So they made it easier for everybody. We ain't going to have Army Rangers and Navy SEALs like we used to have. Martina Navratilova got in big trouble because she is a gay woman, but she said it's not fair for trans men to compete against women. Oh, outrage. That's outrage. And now there is a battle between the gay women and the trans. There's going to be a divide. They're fussing. What are we going to do? Listen. They're fussing. I'd like to see that fight.
Yeah.
We'd pay to see that, wouldn't we, Kelly? It's like a Christian fight. You ever been in a Christian fight? Boy, if I wasn't a Christian, I'd knock you down. Well, if I wasn't a Christian, I'd lay you out right now. If I wasn't a Christian, I'd cuss you. If I wasn't a Christian, I'd let you have it. That's a Christian fight. A sinner fight is just start fighting. Christian fight, if I wasn't, buddy, you'd have it. We could all. Ever been in one of those fights? I have to say, I never have. They're all together become filthy. They're all equally bad. Together they become filthy and corrupt, obscene and offensive, obscene, indecent, dirty, smutty, rude, improper, corrupt, coarse, bawdy, unrefined, indelicate, vulgar, lewd, racy, and raw. I leave anything out? That's what God thinks of sinners. And people think that God is proud of us and our tolerance and our equality. I'm against equality. You know why. I'm against equality. Because it makes everybody the same. That's what they want for your children. You know, let's make everybody equal. Let's let everybody score 20 points. Don't keep score on the scoreboard. That offends people. Let's make everybody equal. Does that make men men and women women? Does that make us better, really? Even God says He'll give rewards. Faithfulness, rewards, precious jewels, or wood, hay, and stubble. God wants the church to work not for salvation, but for His glory and your reward. The most rewards are those who forget about rewards but think about God's glory. That's how you're going to get the most rewards. How can I glorify God and lift Him up? Psalm 53:3, they've all become filthy, there's none that doeth good. Matthew 19:17, Jesus made that famous quote. He said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, and that is God." Amen. Romans 3:12, they are all gone out of the way, they're all together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. The Apostle Paul quoting from Psalm 53. No, not one. No, not one. There's a song about Jesus. There is not a one like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. There's no one like Jesus. And there's not a single person that's going to go to heaven based on their own righteousness. Not based on religion. There's not a religion in the world that can save you and take you to heaven. Every religion in the world will send you to a devil's hell. There's not one religion of the thousand, over a thousand, 1,200, 1,300 religions, major religions in the world, or minor religions, that can take you to heaven. There's only one way, Jesus Christ, and faith and trust in Him. No, not one. That's a big predicament. It's like everybody's standing in line. You've been standing in line for hours, and they tell you the event is closed, no one's getting in. You're in a predicament, aren't you? You have to get in. You've got to get in. How would you feel like if you were on the outside of the ark when God closed the door? You talk about a predicament. They had one choice, drown. He is separated from God, filthy, unrighteous. That's man's predicament. Separated from God. Not for a day, not for a year, not for 50 years, not for a lifetime, but forever. That should strike fear in every heart and every mind. Some are fools, some lack understanding. We are all filthy. Man is in a predicament. But there is a way out, because the opposite of predicament is good fortune. We are indeed fortunate to have a loving Father who by His grace has made a way out of this predicament. Yes. He has provided a way out. Escape. It's through faith and trust in Jesus Christ and our sin debt. Out of our hopeless predicament, we can be saved. We can get out of this debt. We can get out of this predicament. We can get out of this trap. We can get out of this horrible future we're headed for through faith and trust in Jesus Christ. We can have a fortunate. We are all fortunate, I guess I should say. Because Jesus Christ has died for everyone, and we can be saved by putting our faith and trust in Him, repenting of our sins. That is telling God, "I'm a sinner, I'm going to change, I'm going to follow You and trust in Jesus Christ." Mankind's predicament solved by Jesus Christ's death.